Hi everyone, Eric here. I just started painting my new comic, Aldous Badger, today. And what I'd like to do is just shoot a video of me painting and just sort of ramble a bit about the technique I'm using and, you know, my thoughts behind the book. So, you know, music's on, the tea is poured, and I'm just gonna get to work. So here I am in the studio with my painting all ready. I hope you can see it okay. I'm working on Fabriano paper. It is it's 140 GSM Fabriano. I am using Holbein paints. I'm only using two colors for this because I'll explain in a second. I'm using Ultramarine Deep and Sepia. Love Sepia. Sepia is a great replacement for black when inking comics. I've used both sepia ink, and this time I'm using sepia paint so I can mix it with other colors and darken it. So I'm mixing it largely with Ultramarine Deep to get something near black but still has a vibrancy that black kind of lacks. I'm just using these three brushes. They are Raphael brushes. Not very expensive, you know, and range from small to a bit bigger. I'm not using anything huge for this. I'm just going to concentrate on the castle right now. So if you can see, I'm painting the first page of Aldous Badger. I finished some foreground stuff over here, and I'll be doing the midground castle, which is the sort of the main view, the main focal point of the drawing. And so I'm painting this, and I've painted comics before, and what I've decided to do differently this time is to sort of do more drawing with the paint. I'm hoping that gives it a certain amount of energy that maybe just paint it, I can't seem to achieve. And the nice thing about this is I'll go back into it with gouache later. And and I can actually erase lines really easily with gouache. So what I'm ending up with are these, it's a very malleable drawing. Like I can totally change the whole thing. But you know, I wanted to have a drawn look, like an illustration, or like traditional comics, rather than just look like simply paint it. I love painted comics too, but you end up with you choose a certain aesthetic that works best for your story. And I think for this story, the most effective way to present it is sort of a mix of painting and drawing. And it's just interesting. Like, you know, comics are a hybrid form anyway. So using paint to draw with is just makes sense. Trying to remember. Oh, I think it was, I learned how to use sepia as a replacement for black from Arthur Rackham, the Victorian artist. He didn't come into my studio and explain this, but I read it in a book somewhere. It was either him or Harry Rowntree. I can't remember. It was a Victorian artist. And it may have even have been Edmund Dulac, now that I'm thinking about it. But one of them, they wouldn't use black ink. They would use sepia ink, and it would avoid that flat look that can sometimes happen with black ink. So you would have this vibrancy and aliveness in the line that otherwise might look really flat if it was done purely with black ink. Especially if you're not using flat colors. So because I want to, you know, have variations in tone in my coloring, I think a sepia would be nicer than a black, because a black is nice for holding color. And this is a little different. So it's just a different look. And I've just decided to go with that. I don't know if it'll work or not. I mean, God, I don't know what I'm doing. Just trying my best. I'm always experimenting. Every drawing I do is an experiment for the next drawing, I guess. It sure feels that way. You know? I'm doing this, I'm already seeing issues, but I'm gonna keep going. I initially was gonna do all this as a very detailed pen and ink comic, but I started to have practical concerns about the amount of time would actually take to do it. My first book was done very detailed pen and ink, and it actually took me 4 years to produce. But you have to understand that, you know, I had to work during that as well. So I was working jobs and coming home and painting, and it was like a 105-page book, and I was doing like other books at the same time. So you just sort of learn as your career goes on what you can manage and what the best approach is for getting the work done. And I'm finding what really works is to have an approach that's not too precious. Because the truth is, it's you have to make comics suit it to the way people read comics. And there's a novelty to really richly detailed comics that people like. But ultimately, people read comics pretty quick, and they'll return for rereads. But, you know, I want to start doing books that are more for that first read, especially where I work for younger readers. You know, I want it to be more fun than maybe I was doing. Like, I feel like my approach wasn't necessarily fun enough. It just felt like I was trying to do these fine art paintings for kids' books. And I'm getting the same response from work that is ultimately funner to draw, that concentrates more on the form and the energy rather than the the detail. And I am detail oriented. I like detail, but there's other, but you know, as I go on, I'm finding the composition is more important than the detail, which is, you know, probably self-evident to a lot of artists, but, you know, and I always believed that, but I wasn't really practicing it. So I'm trying to practice that more, where I'm giving people something immediate to look at rather than something that slows you down when you look at it. Because more detailed art, it's like Scott McLeod says, I think he says this, you know, if the work is more detailed, it slows the eye and it's a different reading experience. And that might not be the exact sort of reading experience that I'm trying to create. It's not how I read comics. I read a lot of different comics, and a lot of different kinds of comics. I read American superhero stuff and indie stuff and European and Japanese, and I'm finding increasingly that I don't need stuff to look like these perfect paintings, and it can almost be detrimental if it slows down the reading experience or creates sudden stops. Like, people are suddenly like, wow, I have to look at this page because it's so detailed. And that can almost be detrimental to the work, because on that first read through, you want people just to skim through almost. You don't want them to be stunned into stopping all the time. I think it's what separates. This is sort of interesting because you can be really perfectly detailed in movies, but the difference is in film, the director controls the speed at which the art is consumed. And when it comes to comics, you can't really control the speed as much, but you can give sort of cues to the reader of how you want things to be read. And if you're doing really detailed work, the cue you're giving is read this slow, which I think will work for certain, you know, certain types of comics. But when it's an adventure story about a chubby badger and making friends with monsters, it doesn't really make sense to have this slow, meditative comic. And I have to sort of take that into account when I'm producing. And there's also a certain satisfaction of working quicker too. It's a bit more, it's like rock and roll, you know, it's energy. And if you're working really detailed, you're sacrificing energy, which is fine. It's just a different approach. And I'm just experimenting with different approaches right now. And I also, like, there's also just a matter of time to produce things. If I do everything really detailed, it's just going to take me forever to do books. And if I can develop a style which people find equally attractive to my really detailed work, then there's really no motivation to do these really detailed books that, you know, that only so many people are reading. And this is another issue. The more books you have out, the more readers you have. Because every book you have is an advertisement for your last books and your new books. So, you know, I've been doing comics for, God, I don't know, 7 years, maybe, and I've got 2 graphic novels out. And, you know, there's other reasons why it slowed down. Illness was one. Parenting. Having to do other jobs. But primarily, I was really slow because I was really fixated on doing these sort of very detailed, aesthetically perfect comics. And I wonder if this is sort of a result of my background in fine art. And when I say background, I mean education. So I went to the Nova Scotia College of Art and Design, which was a great school, and I learned a lot. But I may have come away with this sort of sensibility where everything has to be really refined and perfect. And, you know, I just can't keep that up anymore. It just does not suit the medium. It's not what I'm excited about. And I need to try something different. So, you know, I mean, that might work if I went back into, just illustration, which I've also considered. Because if I just illustrate it and didn't do comics, I could produce more work. Prose, is written quicker than drawings happen generally. And I did try that as a sort of alternative career route to sort of tell these stories. I even wrote 100 pages of Aldous, thinking, well, this will be great. I'll publish it as a book. But I was very unsatisfied with my writing. It's not that I think I'm a bad writer. I think my prose is okay, despite a lack of education in writing. Like, I felt like it was okay. Like, I felt it worked. But I wasn't satisfied with it. I didn't find it a satisfying endeavor. I'm so visual, and I love to be able to tell all these stories in a very visual manner. And I was losing something. I felt, I really felt the absence of the visual when I was doing the prose. I'm when you're a cartoonist, you're doing all these different tasks. Often what people will do is use an analogy to film. So, you're the director, the actor, the set designer, the artistic designer, the writer, the gaffer, whatever. But when I was writing prose, the sense was that all the jobs are gone. Because when you write prose, so much of the work is done by the reader. And in comics, that same work is done by the creator. And the work by the reader happens differently in comics. It happens between the gutters, between the panels and the gutters. So you're giving the reader this series of drawings so that their imagination can spark with those drawings. And with writing, you're just giving them words. And I guess I'm kind of selfish because I want it more than words to convey what I want it to say. I just couldn't get excited about just working in words. Ultimately, it was just, it became sort of, this not very intuitive to me. And I'm sure to a lot of people, prose is very intuitive to them, but it's just not my medium. So if it's not, if it feels like pure work and there's not a lot of joy in it, which I was finding with prose, I felt like I was just not on the right path at that particular time. So I went back but what really made the decision for me is that Aldous is written for my son Henry. And all this is a fairy tale that sort of reflects a difficult time in my life. And it was something that my son and I shared. And I want him to know what that time felt like to me. And I want to open up a discussion with him about that. And I felt a comic. Well, no. I mean, prose would have been fine. The reason I want to do prose is I thought it'd be nice to write a book for Henry and then read it to him. I thought, how cool is that? Because I've never enjoyed reading comic books to people, to be honest. I've tried, and I just don't find that reading comics really works to children. Because you're pointing to the panels, you're saying, oh, we're here now. And you end up, it's like comics are a personal experience where reading aloud isn't. And it's not as fun for me to read aloud comics. I've done it at book readings and stuff, and that's kind of fun for a little bit, just to sort of share and do the silly voices and stuff to a large group of people. But ultimately, I like the idea of comics as a sort of personal experience. You're sitting down, you're flipping through a graphic novel on your own, and you're sort of communing with the creator of the community. You know, there's a back and forth. You're putting in your own sort of creative thinking into the book. And that's what I wanted for Henry. But what really got me is Henry, when I told him I was doing it as a prose book and not a graphic novel, he got really upset with me. He was like, no, Dad, I want a comic, because he knows I'm dedicating this to him. So I was like, well, forget this. My son wants a comic. I'm doing a comic. So I started doing it as a comic. And he's 9 now. And this is sort of a middle grade comic. So he'll be the perfect age to read it when I'm done. But, I mean, honestly, I don't write for any particular age. It just kind of comes out that way. So I write them to sort of satisfy myself. But he'll be a good age for it when it comes out, I think. So that's good. Keep worrying, I'm gonna have this major disaster right now. That my tea is gonna go flying and spill all over my work. So, I'd like to talk a bit about my Patreon too. It would be really helpful if you donate it $1 a month. I find that income has become absolutely essential every month. And and it saves me from having to get, helps me from having to get sort of menial work to support my comics in my house. So I like every month it just saves me. It's crazy. food or bills. It's just become absolutely essential. I don't know what I would do without my patrons, honest to God. You know, most of my income is made royalties, selling art, patrons, and it's all essential. It's like this equation that is just fragile, but everything's essential in there for me to survive, especially right now. This has been a pretty tough year for me, to not having to go out there and look for menial work has really been a godsend through all of this, I have to admit. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but I'm keeping my head above water and able to do art more, which is good. I'm hoping to, then when I have this done, I'll be able to get the advance for that. Hold on, I'm just going to change the music here. There appears to be some issues musically. I just think my there we go. I think I'll just do 30 minutes today. How's it looking? Castle's coming along. Pull out a bigger brush in a second. Okay. I think I'll leave it at there for today. I'd like to do these videos more frequently. And sort of get into the habit of it. It's just on my phone, and I'm not a great filmmaker, so. But I hope you enjoy them. Okay. Thanks so much for tuning in, guys. I'll be back soon. Bye.